anytime I come to Scripture, I have to pause and just ask the Holy Spirit to guide me, to teach me, to help me have insight to what He's saying here. And I tell you what, every passage, virtually every time I approach the Scripture, God shows up in an amazing way. I cannot believe that I get the privilege of teaching this Bible to God's people here at CrossWay. It's one of the greatest joys of my life. I spend some time in it. I spend time writing on it. As I process through it, there's a principle, and we've talked about this principle this week. If you've been with us at any of our Holy Week activities, we've talked about this principle all week. And the principle is this, that God desires for His people to stop, to consider, to think about, to process, to chew on His word to us. We know this already as we read the Old Testament, right? In the Old Testament, His people, God would tell His people, I want you to take a holiday, a feast, a festival, something, so you stop and you remember the things that I have done. So God would do something big on behalf of His people. He'd show up in a way that they could not miss. And when they would see what He has done, they would worship, and He would say, I want you to do this every year. I want you to sit. I want you to think about. I want you to contemplate what I have done. And what does that do for His people? The goal there is for His people, and we teach our kids this too, don't we? The goal there is for us to be filled with what it is that God has done for us, to consider what He's done, to let that marinate in us, to let that change us, and then as an overflow of that, we celebrate, don't we? Amen. We worship. So the principle there is that we stop, we intake the very things that God has done, and it works in us, and then we worship, we celebrate. And as we gather here this morning, this is what we do. We stop this morning, and we take in, we remember, we consider deeply what God has done on our behalf by sending His Son, Jesus Christ, to the cross. And this morning, as we've spent the week considering those things, this morning we celebrate. We worship, don't we? Because we've spent time in this. And you know this is true, right? You know that this principle from Scripture is true because you've seen it in your own life, right? You pull out the family pictures, right? You start getting out all the big thick books out of the closet and you pull them down, and what do? You look through the pictures and you think about the good old days, right? You think about when you got married, you look through your wedding pictures, you think about your children when they were young, you think about your parents, and you look through the pictures and you consider, don't you? And then it wells up inside emotions. That's the principle. So it's not a surprise to us. And today, the thing that we're considering, the question that we are asking this morning is simple. Simple question. But it's also very profound. I would ask you this morning, when did you believe? When did you believe? The scripture that we're going to in the book of John, I was reading it in preparation, and I've read it over and over and over again. As a matter of fact, I fear sometimes that I've read it so many times that it would become maybe too familiar, right? But as I was reading it the last few weeks in preparation, it just began to become so clear to me that even the followers of Jesus, those who were with Jesus for 3 years or more, even those followers didn't all believe at the same time. They all had different experiences. They all had different times or opportunities in which Jesus revealed Himself to them, and they become believers. And so my question for you this morning is, when did you believe? Some of you, as you let that marinate, you think back and you think, I remember. I remember the day. I remember the prayer. I remember the difference. I remember getting baptized. I remember those things. And some of you said that journey was really long, right? It was a long, long journey. And someone sitting beside you is like, yeah, man, I remember praying for you, right? I remember your journey coming to belief. Some of you in this room this morning, you were invited because you were loved, right? And you may not be believers yet, right? You know we're here to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus, and you're having a hard time with that, right? You're like, people don't normally raise from the dead, and that is true. That's why we call it a miracle, right? Not Thursday. It's a miracle. It's something that's out of the ordinary, unusual that happens, and that's why we gather with other Christians all over the planet, literally billions of Christians gathered together today to worship Jesus because we believe that he rose from the dead. And I would ask you this morning, if you're not yet a believer, would you consider being a believer? Will you give God the opportunity to speak to your heart this morning as we jump into his word and look at his word to us? It's amazing, the scripture that we hold. There's nothing like it. We would have no idea about God except for him revealing himself to us through the Bible, through the book that we have. There's nothing like it. And I'm not spending time today, which I could, but we won't do it today. I have in the past, but we won't do that today to show you why this is absolutely true. We're just going to read this together, consider it together, and celebrate. And remember when you believed. I can still get excited about it. Open their Bible to the book of John. John was a close friend of Jesus, not just a disciple, but really one of Jesus' inner three. He was a very close friend to Jesus. And the account, his account of the resurrection is found in chapter 20 of his writings. And so this is an incredible account of Jesus' resurrection. And yes, there's other accounts in our scripture. The four gospels have an accounts of Jesus' resurrection. There's, as a matter of fact, there's accounts outside of the scripture, just ancient texts that write about Jesus' resurrection and all of the events that took place. But today we get to hone in on the book of John, and we get to see John's account. He was there. He had a front row seat to the events that took place. He's not writing as one who read about it, right? He's not writing as one who saw a tweet about it. He's writing as one who was there with Jesus as this event happened. And he's clear on why he's writing. He wants us to believe. John chapter 20 verse 31 says this, "But these things are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name." What you believe has implications. So this morning as we consider the text, I'm going to stop and I'm going to ask the Holy Spirit to speak to you, to reveal to you his truth. He'll do a better job at that than I will. So let's pray together. Father, we're humbled to come to you. We're thankful for your word. We're thankful that you've invited us in, that you've illuminated what Jesus, who he was and what he's done for us. We're grateful for that, Father. We want today to really contemplate and think deeply about and consider the things that Jesus has done for us on our behalf. Father, we want to stand in absolute amazement that he is raised from the dead as King of kings and Lord of lords, and that he lives to this day. And that in him we have a hope. And Father, I pray that you would, Holy Spirit, that you would allow those in this room who, as they're thinking and considering, they don't believe at this moment. I pray, Holy Spirit, that you would draw them to yourself. And it's in the name of Jesus we pray these things. Amen. Before we jump in to chapter 20, we need to rewind a little bit, right? Sometimes to make sense of what we're celebrating, we need to rewind and look. So let's go to chapter 19 together, and we'll start at verse 38. John writes this, "After these things," what things is he talking about? The death of Jesus on the cross, right? "Joseph of Arimathea, who was a disciple of Jesus, but secretly for fear of the Jews." He was a wealthy Sanhedrin, right? A member of the Sanhedrin. So he was an official. He was like a representative of the government. Think like our Congress, if you will, for really a lack of better terms. And he was a wealthy man. And he was a follower of Jesus. What did it say there? Secretly. Some of you are like, I'll sign up for that team. Some of you are like, you mean I can be a secret follower of Jesus? Let's keep reading. He asked Pilate that he may take the body of Jesus, and Pilate gave him permission. So Pilate's the one who condemned Christ. So he came and took his body away. Verse 39. Nicodemus, introduced to another guy, right? We'll remember him in just a second. Also, who earlier had came to Jesus by night, came bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes and 75 pounds in weight. Remember Nicodemus coming at night to Jesus? He also was a wealthy member of the Sanhedrin, a Jewish leader, official. And so he's coming at night to learn from Jesus and ask Jesus questions. And Jesus says, you have to be born again, right? And he's like, I don't get that, right? And Jesus is saying, you're not really listening to what I'm saying. You're not getting it. And so he went away saddened, and he did not become a believer at this time. Hey, that's encouraging, though. Nicodemus was not a believer when he interacted with Jesus and left. And then through time, he became a believer. Do you believe that God is still drawing people to himself?
Amen.
He is. He's still drawing people to himself. So he brought this mixture of myrrh and aloe, 75 pounds in weight. So they took the body of Jesus, and they bound it in linen cloths with the spices, as it is the burial custom of the Jews. Now in the place where he was crucified, there was a garden. And in the garden, a new tomb in which no one had yet been laid. So because of the Jewish day of preparation, since the tomb was close at hand, they laid Jesus there. So what's going on? Jesus was on the cross. He died on the cross. Nicodemus and Joseph Arimathea said, we can't leave him up here. You know what would happen if there wasn't someone to claim his body and to move him to a tomb, especially this day of preparation was coming for the Sabbath, and he could not be hanging on the cross. Oftentimes, if they didn't have someone to do that, they would have just kind of tossed his body in the ditch, and the dogs would have consumed it. But here, first to fulfill Scripture, right? It says in the Old Testament that Jesus would be buried with the rich, with the wealthy, and he was wealthy, and so he's given of his tomb there. And so I want you to see this. I think it's important as you consider to stop and think about what this would have looked like. Everything's in a rush. Everything's in a hurry. The day the Sabbath is coming, we have got to do something with the man on the cross. And then his disciples say, you know what? We can't allow that to happen. We will go. We will get him. And what are we going to do with him? I don't know, but I've got a tomb, right? I've purchased the tomb. And I want you to see some pictures of what this would have looked like here. It's cut out of rock, right? Most of you didn't realize this is in the side of a mountain, of a rock mountain. And what they would do is they would cut a hole out in the side of the rock mountain. And then they would begin to get inside the hole. And there was just enough room. Now, this was a new tomb, so this has not been used yet. So they would stand up, have just enough room to stand up and kind of do their preparation and their work while they were in the tomb, right? And so in the tomb, they would have a couple of different ways of doing this. First is there in the very front, you can see where there's a little well section there, this section right here would allow a big stone to be placed there. Many of you have heard the story, right? The stone will be rolled over there and then rolled back as needed. Couple of things. The wealthy had the rolling stones, right? That's funny. You get it? Ha ha. Only the wealthy had the stone that actually rolled back and forth. The others would have more of a cork system. They would cut out another rock, and they would shove that rock in the hole there, and that would be the cork system, right? And then as other folks died, they would uncork it or roll the stone out of the way. Other family members, they would go in, and they would dig different chambers in there. So this one didn't have all of those different chambers in it. It was new. And then again, the custom, I think there's another picture here of maybe the inside cutout. Yeah, save that one right there just for a second. So what they would do is they would come in the tomb, and they would take these 75 pounds of myrrh, other spices, liquids, and they would take the cloths, and they would wrap the body like a mummy, right? They would wrap the body in those cloths. They would lay it on a rock bed in there, and then they would kind of go away, right? They would go away for a year, right? And during the year, the spices in the mummified body would decay, right? And they would go back in the next year, and they would kind of sweep up the bones, and then they would take the bones and put in ossuaries, right? This is called an ossuary. And so they would take the bones, put them in the ossuary, have another little ceremony. The top just comes on and off of it. and then they would cut out another little place, and they would put the ossuary box and the bones kind of slipped into a little place in the tomb. And then it frees up the bed for the next family member, right? The next family member goes there, same system, gets a box, an ossuary box, puts it in the thing. Did Jesus ever make it to the ossuary box? He didn't need it, didn't he? But when you think of this mummified wrap, we think of Lazarus, right? When Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead and he came out of the grave, he still had all of that on, right? Because how's he going to get it off? And so Jesus instructs the people to take that off for him. So it's really, really interesting how they did that. But that's why they had to have a stone or a cork or something to move and to uncork that. But in verse 42 here, it says that Jesus died on this Jewish day of preparation. So if you went to Deuteronomy chapter 21, you'll find that they could not leave criminals hanging on the cross, right? They could not do that. They would not do that. And so they're trying to figure out what they're going to do, right? And so as you can imagine this process, it probably had cost Joseph what? Probably a lot, right? Joseph of Arimathea, wealthy guy, probably cost him a lot. The day was getting away, trying to make a decision. He says, you know what? My tomb is close. I'll donate it. I'll dedicate it. Let's put Jesus in there. If only he knew that Jesus was going to give it back, right? I don't think he really knew that, but if he hadn't known that, that would have been pretty awesome. I want you to see here, though, that God orchestrated and allowed all of these things to take place that we're looking at. He allowed Nicodemus and Joseph to donate this tomb and give this tomb. And the circumstance just is so amazing to me. It all had to work just right for this to come about. And so, however, they must not, as we get into chapter 20, it looks as if in chapter 19 that they did not finish this process of burial, right? They're in a hurry. The day of preparations when he died. The Sabbath is coming. We're in a hurry. They went. They started wrapping Jesus' body. They started getting it all fixed up. But it looks as if there was something that was left out, and they had to return here in chapter 20 to finish it. So let's look at chapter 20, verse 1. Now, on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb early while it was still dark. This is the last watch of the night, right? The last watch of the night. So think somewhere between probably 5 and 6 a.m. I woke up really early this morning. My wife, I must have woke her up, and she said, what time is it? And I said, it's the first watch. I mean, it's the last watch of the night. And Mary is at the tomb. That was our little game at home this morning. So around 5 or 6 a.m., still dark, she had saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. The stone that they rolled over it to get access to it, right? We know from other sources that the Roman soldiers were there to guard it to make sure that no one stole the body. And now this stone is rolled away. That's what we learn here. Verse 2. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciples, the one who Jesus loved. If I ever write a book, I'm going to do like John. I'm going to start quoting to myself, referring to myself as the one that Jesus loved. And he said to them, or she said to them, they have taken the Lord out of the tomb. Did she believe yet that he rose again? They stole him. They've taken him out of the tomb. We do not know where they have laid him. So Peter went out with the other disciple, and they were going towards the tomb. Verse 4, both of them were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. John's a lot like me, right? You see, John is the real tone, health nut, you know. This is about 2.5 miles from where they were in Bethany to the tomb. So it's about a 2.5 mile, like a, you know, I would call it the resurrection 5K, right? John's like, I won. I'm just saying, I won. He's just wanting to point that out, that he won and that Peter was slow and out of breath. What do you do? Verse 5. Some of you are like, it makes me believe Scripture more, right? Because what dude wouldn't add that? I mean, if you were in the race, I ran last year. Notice this. Last year, on Saturday, prior to Sunday, I ran a race. One of our guys, I came in first of the CrossWay team. You know what I did on Sunday? I let you know. Like, I beat Josh Bobo and all the guys running the race, didn't I? I did. Notice, we ran last Saturday. I didn't say a word about it on Sunday. I didn't say a word. You mentioned that. Josh came up to me, but I was like, I beat you. Did. So if I'm writing it, if I win, I'm saying I don't blame him. So verse 5, and he stooped to look in. Wait a minute. Yep, he stooped to look in. Remember a picture before? The cutout, the hole, you kind of look in, stoop and look in. That's what he's doing. He saw the linen cloths laying there, but he did not go in. Some of you are like, why didn't he go in? Was he scared? You know, I don't like being in confined areas. I don't know if I could go in. I don't think it's that he's scared. What I think is happening is John is submitting himself. Peter was a leader among equals. All of the disciples were equal, but Peter was the leader of the disciples. He was the leader among equals. And I think John was there first, and he said, I should submit myself to Peter's leadership and allow Peter to enter the tomb first. So verse 6, then Simon Peter came, following him, way, way, way behind, right? A few long, long minutes later in the 5K, Peter eventually gets there. Besides, he needs to go on a diet and lose weight. Then he came following me, went in the tomb. He, this is Peter now, saw the linen cloths laying there and the face cloth, which had been on Jesus' head, not lined with the linen cloth, but folded up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple who had reached the tomb first, just FYI, I'm just saying, very serious moment when it comes to the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, but just want to put in there in parentheses, I got there first. Yeah. Then John also went in, and he saw, and he, what? And he believed. Verse 9 says, for as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must raise from the dead. The disciples, what'd they do? They went back to their home. Mm. What did Peter and John see in that tomb that caused them to believe? That was the first time I really considered this. They didn't see Jesus' body physically raised from the dead. But there was something that was so real to them in that tomb that in that moment they said, in this moment I believe that he's no longer dead, that he's raised from the dead, and that he is Lord. And you think, what in the world did he see? Mary, he's going to pick up here with Mary. Mary, yet, she didn't see it yet. She's not yet a believer. She's not believing that he rose from the dead yet. Did she miss it? There was something that they saw. And here's what John says, they saw the linen cloths laying there. You and I would think, they're just laying there, right? What's the big deal? As you look at the Greek there and you begin to process through, what does the Greek language mean? It means this. It means that laying there precisely or exactly in the position as if the body was laid in it still. Mm. In other words, they were in the same position. The spices and the liquids had done their job and they had hardened into position and they were doing what they were supposed to do, but Jesus' body was not there. This is what convinced the two disciples that he is raised from the dead. When they looked at the cloths while they were precisely in their same position as if Jesus' body were there, what they saw was important, but I think what they did not see was even more important. What they did not see was, they didn't see that the cloths had been cut, right? If you're going to steal a body, you take the whole thing, right? Or if you can't take the whole thing and the cloths are still there, so obviously they didn't take the whole thing, then somebody had to cut it or had to rip it or had to tear it and get the body out. But he's saying, I believe because it was whole. This was something unique, something different, not what we would expect. And it was in those moments that his disciples said, this Jesus that we followed for 3 years, he is who he said he is. He has been raised from the dead. Mm. And then it says that they just went home, right? So Mary's still hanging around the tomb, upset, crying. They're like, I'm going home, right? Somebody should tell Mary, right? We think he's raised from the dead, but apparently somehow they missed it. They didn't even went home. But it, also the second thing they saw here was what? The face cloth, which it says here in scripture, had been on Jesus' head, on his face. But it was folded in a place by itself. Okay. there are all kinds of weird speculation out there on what this means, right? There really is. And I've heard it all. Like the carpenters, when they come to your house and they would finish the task, right? The project for you and you weren't home, you were at work, they would take the cloth and they would fold it and then lay it out. And so you go home, you know, okay, it's kind of like a bill, right? They left the bill on the table. So they would know, I've heard that. I really doubt that's what it is. I've heard two things that really are the opposite, right? First is that when a master was at a table and the servants were serving the master, if the master decided that he was done with the meal, he would just kind of crumple up his napkin and throw it up there, and then the servant would know to come and remove the meal. But if he folded his napkin, right, his cloth, then they would know that he's returning, right? I'm going back and I'm returning. And I've heard that. Then I've heard the opposite of that, right? That if you're at a meal and you're in someone's home and they're treating you well, you would crumple up your napkin and you're finished with the meal. If they didn't treat you so well, instead of being rude and be like, I'm not coming back, you're a terrible host, right? Instead of doing that, they would politely kind of fold their napkin and then you go, oh, they're not coming back, right? That was a process of being kind of mistreated there. I don't think any of those things are right. We truly don't understand or know fully what was taking place and why this folded cloth convinced them that he was raised from the dead. But I can tell you this, here's my speculation. Here's what I think. I think they had spent so much time with Jesus over the last 3 years. They had eaten so many meals with Jesus over the last 3 years that they knew and they recognize the way Jesus folds his napkin after his meal. You know, when Jesus is done, he had a unique way. Some of you have a unique way of doing your folding, right? Some of you fold laundry. You fold your shirts a weird way, but you do it every time. It's your way, right? Your spouse can come in and be like, yep, my wife is the one that folded that because it's folded, what, in her way. I think this was folded in Jesus' way. His disciples knew him so well. They knew his mannerisms. They knew how he folded his napkin after his meal. They knew how he did it. And when they saw that, they identified, this was folded by Jesus. He must be raised from the dead. Let's look at verse 11. Mary's entering this picture now. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. All the other disciples went home. Mary's weeping outside the tomb. And as she wept, she stood to look into the tomb. She looked down in the tomb too, and she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had laid, one at the head and one at the feet. Let me ask you this. What's Mary seeing? She gets in the tomb. She's two angels. What is she seeing? What is this that a Jewish woman, as a matter of fact, a Jewish woman that apparently was not a good woman before Jesus, right? She converted and became a Christian, a follower of Jesus, and it changed her life. He cast out 7 demons from this lady, right? So I don't know that much about demons, but I know if you got 7 demons, you're probably bad, right? You're bad. But he changed her, and she became a follower of Jesus, and she's understanding this Jewish custom and culture, and she's looking in, and what she's seeing is this idea, this Old Testament idea of the mercy seat. You see that? See, God had told his people in Exodus chapter 25, here's what I want you to do. I'm going to bring my presence to you. So in the tabernacle, in the temple, there's a holy of holies. There's a place in which I want my presence to reside. And the mercy seat was there. And that's what she's seeing. So inside the mercy seat was the Ark of the Covenant. As a matter of fact, I think I got a picture. I got a picture up here of the mercy seat as it was drawn out. This was a place where God said, I want my presence to be. And so what would happen is once a year, this was inside the Holy of Holies, the high priest once a year would consecrate himself. He would get rid of all of his own sin and he would come into this place and they would tie like a chain around him, right, and a bell, because as he would go in, if he had any sin in him, he would drop dead and they'd just like pull him out, right? And like, I'm not taking in control, right? But as he would go in and he would splatter, he would do the sacrifice and splatter literally the blood of the sacrificed lamb on the mercy seat. And God would see it. He would forgive their sins. You see the picture? Mary is looking in the tomb and she's seeing the angels just like you see there. And she's seeing the blood of the lamb still fresh, splattered for the sin of the people, right there. This was the very place that as Jesus died on the cross, it says the veil to the Holy of Holies, the place where this mercy seat, the Ark of the Covenant was. It was tore from top to bottom. No man could have torn that. God himself tore the veil at Jesus' death from the top to the bottom, revealing that he desired and had made a way for his people to come into his presence again. They didn't have to be veiled. Amen? I think there may be another picture there of that. That's where it is. The save time. We're going to move on though, right? Can you imagine Jesus' blood still fresh on there as they're seeing that? The Hebrew word for mercy seat in the Old Testament, as it's translated into the Greek of the New Testament, is often translated as propitiary or propitiation, as you've learned. And the English, as they translated it from Greek to English, they were like, we don't really have a word in English that can correctly articulate what we're trying to say. So let's just keep the Greek word propitiation, right? Let's just keep that. I mean, no one will know what it means. We have to explain it, but it's the actual Greek word because there's not really a good word that would describe it in the English language, but it's a term that's indicating the removal of wrath by a gift offering, an offering of a gift. And that's what we see is Jesus. Listen to Hebrews chapter 2, verse 17, as it uses this word. Therefore, he had to be made, this is Jesus, like his brothers in every respect, so that they become a merciful and faithful high priest to the service of God to make propitiation for the sins of all people. Listen to Hebrews 9:11-14. But when Christ appeared as the high priest of the good things that have come, even through the greater and more perfect tent, not made by our hands, that is, but by this creation, verse 12, he entered once for all into the holy places, not by means of blood of goats and calves, but by means of his own blood, thus securing an eternal redemption. For it is the blood of goats and bulls and the sprinkling of a defiled person with the ashes of a heifer that sanctify for the purification of the flesh. How much more will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without blemish to God? That was on our behalf. All right, let's finish with Mary's account. Then, verse 13 of chapter 20 that we're in. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" And she said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." She's not yet believing, right? She's looking in. She's seeing the mercy seat. She's not yet believing. Verse 14, having said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing. She did not know that it was Jesus. Why didn't she know it was Jesus? I don't know. Maybe it was still a little dark and she just didn't recognize Jesus. Maybe she'd been crying so much that her mascara was running, getting her eyes, and she couldn't see really good and she couldn't tell that it was Jesus. Maybe she'd just been exhausted from the last 24 hours, 48 hours, and she just in her exhaustion just couldn't. Maybe she just wasn't really looking for Jesus, right? Maybe she thought Jesus is dead. Why would I be looking for him among the living? I don't really know exactly why. Maybe he looked a little bit different, but she did not recognize him. Jesus, verse 15, said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" Which is a funny question. She's standing in a cemetery at a tomb. He's like, "Why are you weeping?" I don't know. "Whom are you seeking?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you've carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Right, like she's going to lift up the 100-pound body. I mean, the 75 to 100 pounds of wrapping on him and his 150-plus-pound body, right? Let's see. But Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Wow. So John and Peter, looking in the tomb, they believe. For Mary, she saw Jesus standing in his presence and couldn't see it until he spoke to her. It makes me think, what did Jesus say previously? Jesus says, "I'm a good shepherd. My sheep, they know my voice. They hear my voice. They obey my voice." It was the very voice of Jesus that she recognized. Do you recognize Jesus' voice in your life? Do you know that Jesus is calling you to himself? Maybe there are other disciples, right? This is how these two disciples believed, John and Peter. And this is when Mary believed. But you know, the rest of the story, to save us some time, we're going to move on. But there's other disciples, right? When did they believe? Well, for some of them, it was when Jesus walked into the upper room, right? Walked through the door. He didn't open the door. It was locked. And he came in. He's like, hey, I'm here. And then he said, I'm hungry. Somebody give me some fish, right? It's time to eat. I'm hungry. They begin to believe, right? That was the moment for some of them. Some of them, like Thomas, he was like, I can't believe until I get to touch him, right? I want to see him. I want to see the scars. I want to put my finger through it. I want to touch it. And that's whenever Jesus said, okay, here I am, Thomas, do it, right? And Thomas was like, oh, now I believe. And so my question for you is, as his followers, one by one, group by group, up to maybe 500, and then very soon as the book of Acts starts, it's 3,000, then more and more and more and more and more, and now it's in the billions, right, today, that have worshiped Jesus as Lord. They believe that he rose from the dead, because this is where all of Christianity stakes its claims, right? Without the resurrection, there's nothing. We got nada, right? We're going to the house. We're not singing. We're not giving. We're not worshiping. We're not teaching the Bible. We've got nothing. It all rests on this claim. When did you believe? For us, it's important to stop and ask the question, when did we believe?